Welcome to Public Health On Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our focus is the novel coronavirus. I'm Josh Sharfstein, a faculty member at Johns Hopkins and also a former secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal with this podcast is to bring evidence and experts to help you understand today's news about the novel coronavirus and what it means for tomorrow. If you have questions, you can email them to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, I speak with Dr. Urvashi Narain, lead economist at the World Bank for the South Asia region, about her new report entitled Air Pollution, Locked Down by COVID-19, but Not Arrested. Let's listen. Dr. Narain, thank you so much for joining me. I was struck in reading this great report from the World Bank that you said some people are now seeing blue skies for the first time during the coronavirus pandemic because of reduction in air pollution. Is that a metaphor or is that actually true?
Hi, Josh, and thank you so much for having me. It's really a great delight. So we are seeing that the economic lockdown and the severe restriction of economic activity that has followed government efforts to contain the pandemic has had an impact on air pollution. But equally importantly, and it has reduced air pollution, which is why people are seeing blue skies, but equally importantly, not every form of pollution has been reduced.
Got it. So let's talk about the good news and the bad news. So the good news, there are some forms of pollution that have come way down. Which forms of air pollution have come way down?
So one pollution that has come way down is nitrogen dioxide, which is emitted from vehicle traffic, but it's mainly. And from the, as we know, because of the lockdown, there has been severe restriction in mobility. Right? And so severe reduction in the traffic that we are seeing on roads. And so nitrogen dioxide, which is emitted by vehicles, has come down. And we are seeing these amazing images from before and after the lockdown, especially images from satellite data that just show that this pollutant has disappeared.
And so that's the good news. But the not so good news is a different type of pollutant. And what is that and where does it come from?
So the pollutant that is actually most harmful to human health, Josh, is a pollutant called PM2.5. These are very, very fine particles, 1/30th the width of human hair. And these very fine particles, when we breathe these in, they enter deep into our lungs, they enter into our bloodstreams, and they increase the risk of number of diseases that cause premature mortality. So lung cancer, risk of lung cancer goes up, stroke and heart disease. Now, these particular particles come from many sources. They come from transport, but they also come from industry. They come from power generation. They come from household use of biomass for cooking and heating. They come from agriculture, from residue burning. So there are many different forms and sources of PM2.5. And what we are seeing, Josh, is that PM2.5 has not come down as dramatically as nitrogen dioxide.
There's another piece of bad news in there too, in that PM2.5 may make people more vulnerable to severe illness from the coronavirus. Is that right?
Exactly, Josh. And here, you know, the evidence, as you know, is emerging. But the evidence is pointing to is three different mechanisms through which PM2.5 can actually worsen the health consequences of the virus. One is transmission, the second is susceptibility, and the third is severity. So now, coming firstly to transmission, there's growing evidence, right, that the transmission happens via airborne spread of droplets from an infected person, especially when this person coughs or sneezes. And high levels of PM2.5 increase the chances that you will cough or sneeze. And this is the mechanism through which transmission from PM2.5 can happen. Secondly, is that PM2.5 can increase your susceptibility to the virus. Now, why does this happen? the upper lining of the airways have, the cell linings have this hair-like feature called cilia. And these cilia help move the mucus that traps the virus. And they either you express it onto a tissue or you swallow it. And so the virus doesn't enter our lungs. And this is a very important mechanism through which you don't get the virus. Now, air pollution degrades the cell lining and therefore increases your susceptibility to getting the virus. So that's the second. And the third thing is that individuals with certain preconditions, heart disease, chronic pulmonary disease, and diabetes are making up the majority of those who are being hospitalized from the virus. And air pollution increases the risk of each of these diseases. And so it also increases the severity.
So it's both direct and indirect. Now, what parts of the world are we most concerned about when we talk about the fact that there are very high levels of particulate matter still, despite the economic slowdown from the pandemic?
So, I mean, we are seeing, before the pandemic, Josh, some of the highest levels of PM2.5 pollution were in South Asia, so India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, Nepal, all these countries, including in China. Then as you move out of South Asia to East Asia, a lot of concentration in China as well. But you also see PM2.5 concentrations in Eastern Europe, as well as in the Middle East and North Africa. So it's quite widespread. In fact, some of our estimates have shown that before the pandemic, as much as 90% of the world's population was exposed to levels of PM2.5 that are above the WHO guidelines. So, you know, this is a widespread problem of air pollution. And we are seeing varying impacts of the COVID lockdown on PM2.5 levels. So, for example, in France, we are seeing almost no reduction in PM2.5 despite the lockdown. In Beijing, a city that is often called out for high levels of air pollution, again, we are not seeing all the decline in PM2.5. Delhi, another city which has some of the worst air pollution in the world, we saw for 10 days after the lockdown, there was a reduction, but then the levels came right back. And finally, and other cities in India, for example, Kolkata, didn't see any reduction. So really a mixed impact of the lockdown on PM2.5 levels.
So we have a situation where there's a little bit of good news, but mainly we have extra concern that longstanding high levels of air pollution in parts of the world may be making the pandemic worse. And so I guess that brings a extra focus to what can be done to address this problem.
Very well summarized, Josh. And what we are arguing in our paper is that there's a number of things that countries can do. First of all, they need to stay on track. They should not relax environmental regulations in order to spur economic growth.
So they shouldn't say like, well, look, we can see the sky now, so let's just forget about our air pollution control plans.
Exactly. So stay on track, maintain your goals for air pollution management, maintain your programs for air pollution management. The second thing we are arguing countries should do, they should in the immediate try and avoid activities that can lead to spikes in air pollution, right? So try and restrict burning of residue, agricultural residue. So if, for example, in the state of Washington in the United States, we've seen a ban on burning in order to prevent this kind of sort of transmission of the virus. In India also, we are seeing that the government, as part of the COVID response, is providing LPG, so clean cooking fuel, to poor households. And we think this is a great measure because if it reduces the dependence on wood for cooking and cleaning, this will also help reduce the transmission. So governments should think of ways in which they can prevent episodes. And finally, governments should also think about how they can grow their economies back greener and cleaner.
Yeah, so I was going to ask you about that. So we now see that there are extraordinary expenditures that have to be made in order to keep the economy standing. And a lot of countries are asking whether they should be building back what they had before or whether they should be building back differently. And in this regard, how do you think about what can be done for air pollution?
So we are arguing that they should build back differently. They should build back greener and cleaner. And there is evidence that this is possible. So for example, during the 2008 economic crisis, South Korea put in place what they called the Green New Deal at that time, where they invested in new growth engines, but greener growth engines for their economy. So they increased jobs, but they also reduced pollution. So for example, you know, South Korea invested in renewables, it invested in energy efficient buildings, in railways, and it ended up with the world's largest electric car battery factory at that time, which created many, many jobs, but also shifted, reduced the dependence on gasoline and increased the share of electric cars, reducing pollution.
And are there similar kinds of investments that other countries can make regardless of their economic starting point?
Yes. So, you know, we are arguing that because particulate matter comes from many different sectors, you need efforts in different sectors. So, for example, particle matter is emitted from industry. So we are saying that governments should try and provide subsidized loans to industries that are greener and at the same time spur the demand for green products, say through green procurement programs. This will both bring jobs, it will stimulate economic growth, which is much needed, but it will also shift the industry towards a cleaner path. So that's something that industries can do. But there's similarly efforts that can be done on for transport, for power production, for agriculture, and so on.
Got it. So this is a path to maybe blue skies that really do mean a much healthier population.
Exactly. And, you know, we recognize that the current blue skies have come at enormous human suffering and economic costs. So what we are saying is, as governments think of these new ways of growing their economies, they need to shift towards these their growth path so that the blue skies can be permanent and the cost and the blue skies don't come at such, you know, severe human suffering.
Well, thank you so much for explaining all that to me and for the great report that you and the World Bank have published.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you for listening to Public Health on Call, a new podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Please send questions to be covered in future podcasts to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. This podcast is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Lamare Morales. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker and Spencer Greer, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Thank you for listening.